Let's get started on section number 1.6. So this is going to be pressure. And we're going to use pressure the rest of this course. So you really got to make sure you understand what pressure is. And to go over this, what we're going to do is we're going to consider a small rectangular area. And we're going to call it A. And this little area is going to be passing through a fluid at rest. We can also say it's passing through a point. Either way. And a fluid at rest. So the fluid's just sitting there, and then we've got this area going through this point. Now let's draw out this rectangle. All right, so here's our area A. Now, as this is going through the fluid, you got to think about what's happening here. Right? Think about yourself being in a swimming pool. You can feel that water pushing against your skin right in the pool. Well, the same thing is going to happen to this area. So we're going to have these forces that are applied to the surface of this area, and they are going to be perpendicular to the surfaces. So on this right side, we'll have this normal force that's going to the left. It's perpendicular to this surface, and we can say the same thing for all of these other surfaces. And we'll just call it F normal. Okay, and we're going to assume all of these are the same. Okay, because this is just a small area, so there's not a big depth change or anything like that. All right, so we've got all of these little normal forces here. Okay, so these normal forces are going to be compressive forces. All right, because they're pushing in to that area. Now the pressure, which we're going to use the symbol capital P. So the pressure at the specified point, so wherever this area happens to be, is going to be defined as P equals the limit as A goes to A prime, I'll tell you what A prime is in just a second, of F normal over A. So that's going to be your definition of pressure. All right, now this little A prime here, because you're probably wondering what in the world that is. A prime is just going to be the smallest area you can get and not divide by zero. Okay, because we don't want to divide by zero. So you're just trying to take your area down to a very, very, very tiny value. Okay. So this is the real mathematical equation. Now, we're just going to generalize, and we are going to use the equation P equals F over A. All right, so pressure is going to be the force over area. And this is the definition we will be using in here. Okay. Now, pressure can vary from point to point. All right, so think about atmospheric pressure. That changes with altitude, right? So it's varying with point, with location. Or if you think about the ocean, further down you go, the more pressure you have, right? So the depth would change and determine what your pressure would be. Okay, so this is going to be our general equation. We're going to use this a lot. Okay, now let's look at a couple of ways to measure pressure. Okay. And you're going to talk about pressure measurement a lot more in fluid mechanics. So we're just going to briefly talk about it here. You will see it again. All right, so this is section 1.6.1 out of your book. The measurement devices we're going to talk about in here will be manometers and barometers. Okay, and what these do, both of these are going to measure pressure, by looking at a column of liquid. And that liquid is typically going to be something that's got a high density. And the reason why that is because if you had a fluid with a low density, your device, your barometer or manometer would have to be really, really large to measure the pressure. So we use the high density liquids, so something like mercury, for example, and then your devices could be a reasonable size. Okay, so let's quickly draw out a manometer just so you can see what it looks like. Let's move this. So for the manometer, let's say that we have a closed tank here. All right, so this is some pressurized tank. It's got some gas in here, for example, or some fluid. And then it's going to have this U-shaped tube attached to it. This is also sometimes known as a U-tube manometer. Okay, and then it's going to come up like this. Now this over here is going to be open to the atmosphere. Okay, so this is closed. This is open to the atmosphere. Okay. Now inside of this tank there is this pressure P. Okay. Now that pressure P, what it's going to do is it's going to press down on the manometer liquid. So let's draw the manometer liquid in here. So it will make it pink. So here's the manometer liquid. Okay. And what happens is as this pressure from the tank pushes down on this liquid, it's going to force it to rise up in this tube over here on the right. So let's just say it rises up to that level right there. Okay. So at this point here, we've got a pressure being applied that is the same pressure as what we have in this tank. Okay. So you got P here, and then over here, this is open to the atmosphere. Well, there is an atmospheric pressure, right? So we've got atmospheric pressure pushing down on this side, okay? Now, as you'll learn in fluids, you can draw a line, kind of a dashed line right here straight across, and this line right here has the same pressure as over here. And we end up with this length L. Okay. And remember, this is the manometer liquid. Okay. So using this tube and determining how much L changes, we can figure out what the pressure in this tank is, right? Because the higher this pressure is, the higher it is than the atmospheric pressure, the more it's going to rise in this tube. So if you have a really, really high pressure in here, it's going to push all of this fluid up that tube there. All right, and then the equation that you use to calculate this pressure in the tank, if you have a manometer set up, it's going to be P equals the atmospheric pressure, so PATM, plus rho, which rho is going to be the density of this liquid. So let's put rho here. Right, so that's just density for that liquid. And then you're going to have G, which is gravity. And then you've got L. So L is this length here. Okay. So let's define these just so everybody knows. So PATM is atmospheric pressure. And like we said, rho is going to be the density of the fluid. And that's the manometer fluid, not the fluid in the tank. And then G is gravity. And then L is going to be the height of the liquid column. Right? And then just P, that's the pressure in the tank, which that's what we were trying to find. Okay, so that's how a manometer works. You'll see it a lot more in fluid mechanics if you haven't seen it already. Next, let's talk about a barometer. You've probably heard of barometers before if you ever watch the Weather Channel, because they talk about barometric pressure. And this one kind of has a similar theory behind it. structured a little different though. So in this case, we're going to have an open dish, and inside of that dish, we're going to have a fluid. And typically, again, it's some fluid with a high density. So you've got this open dish, it's open to the atmosphere, and then you're going to put this fluid in it. Okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to insert a tube like this. Now what's going to happen, since this is open to the atmosphere has pressure, right? So the atmospheric pressure, actually let's just use black. The atmospheric pressure is going to press down on this fluid that's in the dish, okay? Now, when it pushes it down, what's going to happen is that fluid's going to start rising up in this tube, okay? So kind of similar to what we had with the manometer, right? The pressure pushed it up the tube, same thing here. So again, we're going to have a length that we can measure. So that'll be this L right here. And inside of this tube, there's this little space between the top of the fluid and the top of the tube here. This is going to have a vapor pressure, and that's just the pressure caused by that fluid. This is typically really small, so usually we just kind of ignore that and let it go to zero. All right, and then this fluid here, let's just call it rho sub m. I put M because usually this is going to be mercury. Okay, so now we have that. So for this one, our equation would be atmospheric pressure equals the vapor pressure, which like I said, that usually goes to zero, plus the density of the fluid times gravity times L. Okay. So now, since this is zero, your atmospheric pressure is essentially density, gravity, and then L. So we'll put it's approximately equal to that, since we made this assumption. Okay. So a barometer can be used to calculate atmospheric pressure. So it's pretty cool stuff. And it's really simple setup, but it's actually really effective. So next, let's talk about pressure units, and then we'll talk about something called gauge pressure. So this is section 1.6.3. All right, so now we've got this. First, let's go over these units. So let's look at the SI system first. And unit of pressure will be Pascal. So symbol there is PA. And we have some conversions. So 1 Pascal is equivalent to 1 Newton per meter squared. And if you can't remember this or you ever forget it, remember pressure is force per area. So Newton is force, meter squared is area. Right, so you can figure it out that way. And then 1 kilopascal is 1,000 newtons per square meter. Then we have a unit of a bar. So 1 bar is going to be equivalent to 10 to the fifth newton per square meter. And then finally, 1 megapascal is going to be 10 to the sixth newtons per square meter. Okay, so these are just some of the conversions you'll need later on. In the English system, we're just going to have pound force per square foot and pound force per square inches. It's kind of blending in there. And one more thing we need to talk about before we start getting into gauge pressure. There's also a unit called an atmosphere. Right, and we're going to use this quite a bit, so you might want to make a note of it. So 1 standard atmosphere. The unit for that is going to be 1 ATM, and that is equivalent to 1.01325 times 10 to the fifth newtons per square meter. And It is also equivalent to 14.696 pound force per inch squared. And then finally, it's equivalent to 760 millimeters mercury, so mmHg, and that is equivalent to 29.92 inches of mercury. So they have these units because they use mercury as the fluid so often, so that's where they came up with these terms. All right, so we'll use these quite a bit. So again, you might want to make note of them. They are in the front page, though, if you want that in that table. So here, you'll see them right here. Okay. Now, we're going to develop a lot of equations in here that we're going to be using. And the equations that we're going to develop are all meant to be used with something called absolute pressure. So let's write that down. So the pressure used in the thermo relations is absolute pressure. Now this is going to be important to remember. So this is absolute pressure. Okay. Let me try to focus this again. There we go. Now, the problem with this is that those pressure devices that'll give you a pressure reading, those a lot of the time will indicate the difference between the absolute pressure of the system that you're looking at and the absolute pressure of the atmosphere. So it's not giving you the actual absolute pressure that you need for the equations, because it's giving you this difference. So it's essentially kind of comparing it to the atmospheric pressure. So that's an important distinction to make. All right, so this is where we come up with what's known as gauge pressure. And you'll see gauge pressure a lot in here, because again, that's typically what you get from a pressure measuring device. So gauge pressure, which that's how we'll write it, that is going to be equal to your absolute pressure. So this is the pressure we need for our equations, and then we subtract the atmospheric pressure, so PATM. Okay. So this means when you are given gauge pressure, if you're going to do a calculation using one of our equations that we're going to develop, you need to add the atmospheric pressure to it, because you need to solve for this. Right, so there's a big distinction that you need to make when you're given gauge pressure. Right, so this is definitely one you need to pay attention to. So let's just draw out a little diagram here. So let's say we have an absolute pressure. Let's just make a bar graph. So the absolute pressure goes up to this value, whatever it is. And then we've got our atmospheric pressure. Okay. So this difference right here is your gauge pressure. So essentially it's just kind of, when it gives you the pressure reading, it's kind of subtracting out that atmospheric pressure, so it's not in there, okay? So that's gauge pressure. Now let's say atmospheric pressure is higher than the absolute pressure. In this case, this is what's known, this difference is what's known as a vacuum pressure. Okay? So we can get an equation for that. We won't use this one as much. But vacuum pressure then would be the atmospheric pressure minus the absolute pressure. Okay? So if you are given a vacuum pressure, you need to solve for absolute, right, out of this equation. So you're going to need to subtract the atmospheric pressure and then change your sign. Okay? So just remember, you have to do these conversions if you're given gauge pressure or vacuum pressure in your problem statement. Okay, so let's stop here on this. This is the end of pressure. We'll cover pressure a lot more later on, but the next video will cover temperature. See you there.